There's no point in going in and not being able to communicate your education.
I think they're doing brilliant work, and I'm absolutely honoured to be here. Thank you.
Jodie, if you want to come up.
Okay. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay. See you on the screen.
While Jodie's giving his talk, I'm going to sneak into the house and mess around with one of the rooms he's become most familiar with.
Time's gone. You continue.
As a student,
So most of the changes have been quite subtle up to this point, but we're going to see how he reacts to something that happens right under his nose.
Sorry to interrupt.
Sorry.
Just to get clarification from what you said earlier, you said the size of the bathrooms.
What?
No, they hit it. OK, no, sorry. Wait with 1 second.
Sorry,
if... So, you don't have to worry about anything like that. And obviously, all the files and this, that.
Okay?
Great. So, sorry again.
That's great. Thank you. But you did.
I'm suddenly minus half of my fish. I don't remember it.
I've never had it.
It's just gone.
I've had it in.
No, it's fine.
Yeah.
I must have eaten it. I must have eaten it all. I just didn't. I just thought I had a bit left.
OK, so we now need a dry run for the murder itself, just to make sure that everything's working. So Dan, the house manager's going to come in and say that the Duchess's priceless pearl necklace has been stolen. And Jack's going to say that he saw Jodie with it earlier on, which, of course, isn't true. And it's to see now whether a combination of Jodie doubting his own memory to the extent that he might question whether or not he could have had it, and the guilt that I'm going to trigger by setting off the bell sound will be enough to make Jodie believe that he could have actually stolen it and then go and confess to it.
Amen.
ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry to interrupt, but an item of jewellery has gone missing. It's a pearl necklace. Normally it's kept in a display cabinet behind locked doors, but for some reason that particular cabinet has been unlocked for the last few days. So if anybody has found anything...
Jenny, was that the one you had last night?
In the class? You were just holding it by the window in the drawing room. You were definitely holding it. I'm not saying you should use it, but you were holding it last night. You know, three sets of pearls and had a kind of clasp on it.
If you do see it, then please come and find me. I'll probably be around the desk.
John, to send Jodie up to this room to get the shirt.
Can I grab my shirt? I'm going to go, yeah, that's right, mate. Nice.
Guilt, anger is tripped.
Look, he's hidden it.
Oh, we know he's feeling guilty. He's hidden it. He's given the shirt to John. That's who he was getting it from.
You were okay, aren't you?
All right, yeah.
You don't look okay.
Very funny.
Do you? Yeah. Why is that?
Let's get a tight two shot on camera six.
Yeah.
Jack and said that he saw me with them last night.
Okay.
I don't remember having them.
Right.
I'm sure I've never seen him in my life.
You have them in your room?
Oh, I don't know how they got there.
Oh, that's okay. No, that's all right. I'm just going to get them and say we found them.
Who do I give them to?
Give them to, Dad. Give them to me if you like. I'll say I found them.
No, I should do it myself.
Are you sure?
What if it was me that took them?
If it was me that took them?
Yeah, I should, really.
He's questioning it, isn't he? He's going upstairs. Doubting his own memory.
I won't say anything.
It looks like the dry run to get Jody to confess to something he hasn't done is working. He's responded well to the guilt trigger. We've managed to make him doubt his own memory. And he's starting to believe he took the pearls, which we know he didn't do.
What if it was me that took them?
Because he's confused by events, young, compliant, and exposed to fake information, he fits exactly the profile of the thousands of people who make false confessions to the police every year.
Yeah. Oh, thank God. Thank God. Oh, no, don't worry. It's absolutely terrible. All right, that's absolutely fine. We'll just say that we found them. Don't worry. Thank you so much.
Can walk out and stay on camera one on Jody.
That's great. I am going to go through and see.
Okay, so phases one and two are now complete. We can make him feel guilty whenever we want by using the triggers, and he's doubting his own memory. Third phase is to now give him a sense of a motive. Nothing serious, but just enough that will play on his mind later on. So I've asked Dr. Black to be pretty rude and obnoxious to people within Jody's earshot, and he's been doing that since he arrived.
What was it about you that made you think you didn't need a suit for this weekend? See what I mean?
You behave like this to your family too, sort of gorilla push
family out of it.
Come on, Patrick.
Let's call it, get a hold of yourself. You've had a little too much to drink.
You are summoned out. Really fucking summoned out.
Phyllis, relax.
Now we're going to create a further possible motive in Jody's mind over a game of croquet.
Two giants of croquet, let's go.
Whip his ass, Jody.
So grab your weapons.
Bash somebody's head in with this thing.
You got your wallet with you?
Yeah.
You got 20 quid in there? I'll put the 20 against everything in my wallet.
Shit.
The rules are flexible. Good work. Aren't you in that left room over there?
Anyway, kid.
But I was looking at him, and he was...
I didn't even say.
Apparently, Patrick was cheating.
What, and he took your money? How sad is that, that he felt like he had to cheat on a game of croquet?
Yeah.
Bloody hell. No need for that, is there?
Oh, you're tough. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
There's no limit to what they can order, is there? No, fantastic. I've told the actors to get Jody drunk. It's important.
Have the champagne. Go on, lad.
Who's not got one?
All drink in each hand, Jody. Look at you.
No, I haven't.
Thank
you very much, Steve.
I was five and he was six.
Ah.
You rode on horses made of sticks.
Yes.
You were black and I were white. You would always win the fight. Bang, bang. He shot me down, bang, bang. I hit the ground. Bang, bang. That awful sound. Bang, bang. My baby shot.
Coming next, Jodie's weekend takes a turn for the worse.
There's been a murder.
And we find out if he'll confess to a murder.
You look like maybe you want to say something.
He didn't even commit.
I'm screaming.
In tonight's experiment, we're looking at how we're all manipulated through feelings of unnecessary guilt. And I'm seeing if I can make a wholly innocent man confess to that most abhorrent of crimes, murder.
Our unwitting subject is Jodie, possibly the nicest guy you could meet. So far, we've managed to get Jodie to feel guilty when his left shoulder is squeezed or when he hears the sound of a bell. We've also got him to doubt his own memory, and we've planted the seed of a motive to murder in his mind.
How sad is that, that he felt like he had to cheat on a game of croquet? Yeah.
Not a strong motive, but just something that'll play on his mind later on. Last night, we got Jodie drunk on champagne in order to set up the final phase of our plan. It's 5 o'clock in the morning, and for the next stage to work, I need to talk to Jodie remotely while he's asleep. Now, that would normally wake him up, but what I'll be telling him are instructions to remain asleep. And because I know that he's an open and compliant and therefore fairly suggestible person, this should keep him in a sort of a mid-state between wake and sleep, a dreamy state of inertia called a hypnopompic state. And I need him to be there because I need him to remain asleep while we get him into position. Jodie had a lot to drink last night as well, which makes it easier. We've wired up the television in his room so that we can play in a recording of my voice.
Sleep, Jodie. Sleep nice and deeply. I want you to remain nice and deeply asleep. It's just a dream of my voice. You will remain asleep.
Deeply asleep.